Hello children, welcome to the online edu classes. Today we are going to discuss geography lesson 6 manufacturing industries part 2. After this video the children you will be able to categorize the different types of industries and their challenges. The topics we will cover in this video are textile industries, under this cotton and jute industries, sugar industries and iron and steel industries. So in the previous video we have discussed that industries which obtain their raw material from agricultural products are known as agro-based industries. Cotton, jute, silk, woolen textiles, sugar and edible oil etc. industries are based on agricultural raw materials and known as agro-based industries. In ancient India, cotton textiles were produced with hand spinning and handloom weaving techniques. Power looms came to India in the 18th century. Our traditional textile industries suffered a setback during the colonial period because they could not compete with the mill-made cloth from England. It is the only industry in the country which is self-reliant and complete in the value chain, that is, from raw material to the highest value-added products. The first successful textile mill was established in Mumbai in 1854. India has the largest installed capacity of spindles in the world, with 43.13 million spindles after China. Now, let us discuss the contribution of textile industry in the Indian economy. Textile industry contributes 14% industrial production. Approximate 3.5 crore people directly employed in the industry. It earns about 24.6% foreign exchange. It contributes 4% towards GDP. In the early years, the cotton textile industry was concentrated in the cotton growing belt of Maharashtra and Gujarat due to the following reasons. Maharashtra and Gujarat were the major producers of cotton. So, availability of raw cotton. Second, market. Third, transport, including accessible port facilities, which means Gujarat and Maharashtra had ports which helped in the transportation of the finished goods to various locations. Labor, the adjacent area of Gujarat and Maharashtra, and even these states have dense population. So, the availability of cheap and skilled labor is easy. Moist climate etc. contributed towards its localization. The moist climate of both the states suited the temperature that is required for the cotton industries. The cotton threads tend to break in dry climate while they rarely break in moist and humid climate. India exports yarn to Japan and other cotton goods to USA, UK, Russia, France, East European countries, Nepal, Singapore, Sri Lanka, and African countries. Now, let us discuss the reasons behind the decentralization of weaving of textile industry in India. In India, weaving is highly decentralized to provide scope for incorporating traditional skills and designs of weaving in cotton, silk, zari, embroidery, etc. Weaving is done by handloom, power loom, and in mills. Now, let us discuss about the major drawbacks or challenges faced by cotton textile industry in India. The weaving, knitting and processing units cannot use of the high quality yarn that is produced in the country because these all yarn are exported to the foreign countries. erratic power supply, outdated machinery led to the low output of labor. There are some large and modern factories in these segments, but most of the production is in fragmented small units which cater to the local market only. As a result, many of our spinners export cotton yarn while apparel or garment manufacturers have to import fabric. Now, let us discuss about the jute industry. The first jute mill was set up near Kolkata in 1859 at Rishra. After partition in 1947, the jute mills remained in India, but 3/4 of the jute producing area went to Bangladesh, erstwhile East Pakistan. India is the largest producer of raw jute and jute products and stands at second place as an exporter after Bangladesh. There are 80 jute mills in India. Now let us discuss about the factors responsible for their location in the Hooghly Basin. First, proximity of the jute producing areas. As this area has a favorable climate, or you can say provide favorable climate for production of the jute, for cultivation of the jute. So the jute producing areas are nearby only. Second, inexpensive water transport, supported by a good network of railways, roadways and waterways to facilitate movement of raw material to the mills. As you know that while processing raw jute, it needs abundant amount of water. So abundant water from Hooghly River for processing raw jute, cheap labor from West Bengal and adjoining states of Bihar, Orissa and Uttar Pradesh is available. Kolkata, as a large urban center which provides banking, insurance and port facilities for export of jute goods. As jute industry was facing stiff competition in the international market from the other competitors, so in 2005, National Jute Policy was formulated with the objective of to increase demand and productivity, to improve quality and to ensure good prices and enhance yield per hectare. As I told you about, the jute industry is facing stiff competition in the international market. So let us discuss about the challenges faced by jute industry. As jute industry is facing stiff competition in the market from synthetic substitutes like nylon, most of the machinery in jute industry are old, and due to this the output of laborers is very low. Jute industry is facing stiff competition in the international market from other competitors like Bangladesh, Brazil, Philippines, Egypt and Thailand. The growing global concern for environment-friendly biodegradable materials has once again opened the opportunity for jute products. Sugar industry. India stands second as a producer of sugar and occupies the first place in the production of gur and khansari. There are over 650 sugar mills in India. In recent years, there is a tendency for the mills to shift and concentrate in the southern and western states, especially in Maharashtra. This is because the cane produced here has a higher sucrose content, which means more sugar to produce. The cooler climate also ensures a longer crushing season. The cooperatives are more successful in these states. Now let us discuss the problems or challenges faced by sugar industry. First, the seasonal nature of the industry. As you know that sugarcane takes almost 1 year to mature or to harvest, you can say. So the nature of this industry is seasonal only. Old and inefficient methods of production. Third, transport delay in reaching cane to factories, which make the sucrose content less in the sugarcane. And there is a need to maximize the use of bagasse. So students, let us understand the iron and steel industry. The iron and steel industry is the basic industry, since all the other industries, heavy, medium and light, depend on it for their machinery. Steel is needed to manufacture variety of engineering goods, construction material, defense, medical, telephonic, scientific equipment and a variety of consumer goods. So steel production is the backbone of any country's economy, since it is the basic unit for the development of the nation. Almost every industry depends on iron and steel for its manufacturing and production. In today's era of globalization, consumption of goods is increasing. Thus, it can be concluded that growth in production of steel is regarded as the index of country's development. Iron and steel industry is a heavy industry because all the raw materials as well as finished goods are heavy and bulky. Iron ore, coking coal and limestone are the required in the ratio of 4:2:1. All are heavy and bulky. Some quantities of manganese are also required to harden the steel. India holds 9th place with 32.8 million tons of steel annually, and it is the largest producer of sponge iron. The per capita consumption is 32 kilogram per annum. There are two types of steel industry. One is mini steel plants. Mini steel plants are smaller, have electric furnaces, use steel scrap and sponge iron. They have re-rollers that use steel ingots as well. They produce mild and alloy steel of given specifications. Whereas integrated steel plant is large and handles everything in one complex, from putting together raw material to steel making, rolling and shaping. Now let us discuss why Chota Nagpur Plateau region has the maximum concentration of iron and steel industries. It is largely because of the relative advantages this region has for the development of this industry. Low cost of iron ore and high grade raw materials in proximity, which means that this region has vast reserves of coal and iron ore. Also, iron ore is cheaply available in the region, thus providing the raw materials for iron and steel industries. Cheap labor is available to the industries from the states of West Bengal, Bihar, Jharkhand, Odisha and Chhattisgarh. This region has immense potential for growth in the local markets like Kolkata, Patna, Ranchi, etc. Let us discuss about the challenges faced by the iron and steel industry in India. High cost and limited availability of coking coal. As you know that on the earth, the high grade of coking coal is very limited, so the cost is very high. Lower productivity of labor due to the obsolete machineries and unskilled labors, the productivity is also very less. Irregular supply of energy means power supply is not regular to these industries, and the poor infrastructure. But the liberalization and foreign direct investment have given a boost to the iron and steel industry with the efforts of private entrepreneurs. Thank you, children. Let us meet in the third video of this chapter.